So today is the 10th episode of the second season of Medic2 Masterclasses, which was on neuropsychiatry. And we will be summing up all those small bits that we have learned through the last 9 episodes through today's clinical session, which is a conduction of the psychiatric interview. So as usual, we'll start with a few questions. So I have a few questions for you. I would be glad if all of you can answer this. And then we'll get back to the same questions at the end of the session. So here comes your first question. A 56-year-old man drew this image when he was asked to draw a clock face and mark 6 o'clock on it. What is the most probable diagnosis? The next question. An interviewer asks, what is the similarity between an orange and an apple? So with the help of this question, what is the interviewer trying to analyze? The third question. So a person was asked to draw a spiral. We have the pictures of individuals with no tremor and individuals with essential tremor. In the middle, you find the drawing of person X. What is person X probably suffering from? The next question. CAGE questionnaires are aimed at investigating which attribute? The last question. Flamboyant dressing, pressure of speech, and inflated self-image may indicate which of the following? So with these introductory questions, let us today start our discussion on an outline of the psychiatric interview. The psychiatric interview is a very elaborate process and it involves many individual parameters to be assessed. There are disease-specific testings and there are some general testing also. Today, I'll mainly confine my discussion on the general testing in case of a psychiatric history taking. Now, the basic psychiatric assessment requires that before you begin, you talk about the information that you have received, like the referral letters, the location and safety of the person. Introduce yourself, take the consent, and then also establish expectations. So you also ask, what is the expected outcome of today's interview? So do not give an expectation that with only one session, all problems are going to be cured. So it's very important that you also set a limit to the expectation, and that usually makes the patient very happy at the end of the session. The basic details like the method of referral, whether the person was referred from a psychiatric facility, by a friend, by a doctor, by a general physician, by an endocrinologist, all these usually give you some hint about the demographic profile of the individual. Inquire about the age, marital status, occupation, and the current living arrangements. They often help in formulating therapy. Personally, it also helps in understanding whether there are good caregivers and affordability of treatment. The basic history is similar as in any other branches of medicine. So you talk about the presenting complaints, their details, past history, family history, personal and premorbid personality history, social history, history of substance use like smoking, alcohol, or illicit drugs, forensic history, whether there is any history of medico-legal issues or crimes, or whether there is any tendency to get involved with crimes very easily, and past medical and drug history. Now, we also do something extra in psychiatric assessment, which is called mental status examination. And this includes examination of the appearance and behavior, speech, mood, thought, perception, cognition, and insight. We will go through these one by one. And at the end, we will also discuss about how the whole thing can be summed up by a risk assessment, physical examination, corroborative history from family members and friends, and if necessary, investigations. So the first part is on history taking. So how does psychiatric history taking differ from the general medicine history taking? Let us see. So as usual, you take down the patient's personal details. Sometimes they usually prove to be useful. They are also important medico-legal records. So the name, age, the gender, marital status if it is applicable, occupation, religion or ethnic groups if the patient wishes to express that. These are very important details. After that, you come to the presenting complaint. Now, a general rule is that you record the presenting complaint in the language of the patient. So if the patient is saying that I am hearing words coming from the wall, or if the patient is saying, I think the government is conspiring to kill me, you write that verbatim the way the patient has said. Your analysis might later on be interpreted, but the presenting complaint must be written in the words of the patient. Document how long the patient has the problem. So you ask, can you remember the time when this kind of conspiracy was not there? Since when do you feel the conspiracy started? So that is how you try to understand the duration of the problem. Use open-ended questions. Can you tell me about the problems that brought you here? Instead of directly asking, are you depressed? Are you anxious? Do you hear sounds? These are leading questions. So do not use leading questions. Use open-ended questions. Leading questions are always asked at the end of the interview for eliciting negative history. But for the so-called positive history taking, you must always ask open-ended question. And the way you know that your question is open-ended or non-leading is that your question cannot be answered by yes or no. So this is how you know that your question is not a leading question. Let the patient speak uninterrupted for the first few minutes, usually for the first 5 minutes. So do not interrupt. Let the person speak. What is important in psychiatric history taking is, it is not only what the patient says is important, but it is also how the patient says is equally important. So these 5 minutes is your first rapport building session. You are opening up the window for the patient to express themselves. And therefore, you are not only judging the content of the history, but also the mannerisms, the stereotype behaviors, the hand movements, the gestures, the flow of the speech. Everything is getting assessed simultaneously when the patient is speaking up. In the history of present illness, you usually ask by saying, when did the problem start? And has it changed over time? I mean, if you are hearing sounds from the wall, have the sounds increased or decreased? Do they happen at a particular time? Did it happen after some major events like bereavement or divorce? Is there any psychological or drug treatment for the current problem? So like, are you already under therapy? And if so, then what drug were you taking and did it actually help you? This also helps you to formulate certain kinds of diagnosis. Suppose your diagnosis is going to be some sort of psychosis and you are planning to give antipsychotic medication. But the patient says that I took haloperidol and then my body became very stiff, so the doctor had to change that medicine. So you know that this person is prone to extrapyramidal side effect, and accordingly, during selection of your own prescription drug, you will be trying to avoid drugs that are prone to cause EPSs. Screen for any other problems. All patients should be asked about suicidal ideation, depression, anxiety, obsessional behavior, and psychosis. Past medical and drug history is very important, so inquire regarding any significant illness, operation, or accident. Sometimes the accident might mean that in the past the patient might have had another manic episode and drove very fast. Or maybe there was a surgery to remove bezoar or hair balls from the stomach, indicating that there is a trichotillomania or OCD spectrum disorders. Do they take any regular medications? That is a very important history, because the patient may be hypertensive, the patient may have ischemic heart disease, and therefore you have to be precautious while administering a drug which is monoaminergic or noradrenergic in nature. What medication have they taken previously for their mental health, and was it effective? Again, it helps in screening the drug that you want to prescribe. Take a proper family history. Is there a family history of mental illness? There are certain mental illnesses that run in families. Although we really do not know the nature of the genetic transmission, but many diseases like bipolar disorders, depression can run in families. Collect information about parents, siblings, and other significant relatives. Inquire about the age, occupation, social circumstance, and quality of the relationship with their patient. And you can also make a genogram, which is like analyzing the family chart. You make a family tree and mark similar conditions in the family if they're occurring. Personal history is very important in psychiatry because the person as a whole has come to you for getting the therapy. It's not only the auditory hallucination or delusion that needs treatment. It is the person's overall well-being that needs to be regarded. So take specific childhood history, whether there was any significant birth history, like difficulties in being delivered or prematurity, developmental milestones, delay in particular, when you are suspecting some kind of a pervasive developmental disorder or mental retardation, description of the early childhood, family, and home atmosphere. So are there histories of separation? Are there histories of institutional upbringing? Talk about the school, the living age, whether there was any school refusal, bullying, relationship with the peers and teachers, exams taken and qualifications, and further education. List all the jobs and duration of employment, particularly asking for why did you leave a particular job. Psychosexual history is very important. So you ask about the current relationship, if any, sexual orientation, any sexual difficulty, first sexual experience, any form of sexual abuse, past significant relationships, and reasons why they ended. Because there is a taboo in discussing sexuality, so you might reserve these questions for the last part of the interview, when you have gained confidence of the patient. Ask about alcohol and substance use. Alcohol, tobacco, and illicit drugs. Record the amount taken. Whether any symptoms or signs of dependence or withdrawal have happened. And whether there is any associated problem like financial difficulty. Forensic medicine history are very important for typically aggressive patients. Record all offenses, whether convicted or not. Also assure that they are not going to be reported. Ask about the social situation, the type of housing, who else is at home. These actually help in understanding the caregiver facilities. Premorbid personality means how the person used to function before this disorder started. Now that is very difficult to assess in a short interview. Also, if you ask the patient, describe yourself when you were not suffering, that is supposed to give you a very biased answer. It's more like a Facebook profile that the person will open in front of you, giving you some details and not giving you the rest of the details. So it's also important that you get another corroborator, a friend or a family member, to tally the findings. You specifically inquire about attitude to others in relationship, attitudes to the self. What was the predominant mood? Was he always depressed, always euphoric, always anxious? Leisure activities and interests. How does the person handle stress and what are the coping mechanisms? So with this history, you should have some idea of the kind of things going on in the mind of the person. And with this, you have already started the mental status examination. That is because you have already started assessing the speech, the flow, and the content. So what are the attributes that we see under mental state examination? The first look at the patient is also very important. You look at the dress and self-care of the patient. It's likely that if there are bright colors, flamboyant clothing, it may be a feature of mania. Not necessarily, of course, but it may be. So it has to be corroborated with other clinical findings. You will see people who are manic, they often wear a lot of so-called unwanted and unnecessary jewelries to the hospital setting, which is apparently not a very congruent behavior. You can also see self-neglect if there is depression or if there is schizophrenia or catatonia. Look at the overall behavior during the interview. Is the person feeling restless? Is the person tearful? Is the person making eye contact or avoiding eye contact? Is the person irritable? Is the behavior appropriate to the content of the discussion? I mean, is he happy when he is talking of good things and unhappy when talking of sad things? Or is it just the reverse? Is there easy distractibility? Are simple sounds or noise of something in the corridor stopping the person to speak? Look at the psychomotor activity, that is the physical behavior of the person. Is there poverty of movement, that is less movement? That means you may be dealing with a severe depression or catatonia. Are there stereotype behaviors, the same kind of repetitive action that the person does? Are there ritualistic behaviors, like obsessive rituals of keeping everything at the center of the table, sitting at the center of the chair, an obsession for symmetry, for example? Are there other abnormal movements that can indicate even organic pathology? Are there tremors? Are there abnormal eye movements like nystagmus? And also see the level of rapport that has been established during the interview. This is crucial to understand how far you can take the interview at a very personal level. Now, while you are talking to the patient, study the speech and try to record findings under these following headings. Depending on what you are talking about, subjectively, you assess what is the rate of the speech. Is the person speaking too fast? Is the person speaking too slow? These are also clues to the state of the mind, anxiety or paranoia or manic phases or severe depression. What is the tone of the person? Is there a so-called normal tone? Is it monotonic? That is, the person's tone doesn't change. The person speaks in a monotonous voice, irrespective of whether it is something funny or sad. Or is there excessive intonation, an exaggerated level of intonation? Look at the volume of the speech. Is the person whispering to you? Is the person predominantly quiet? Or is the person shouting loudly? What is the content of the speech? Is the person answering in a monosyllabic way, that is using only words like no, or is it a spontaneous speech? The person is out of his or her own speaking, or only answering the questions that you are asking, but not adding anything to it. It also shows the level of involvement and cooperation of the patient, and to some extent, the mental state of the patient. Assess neurological disorders like dysphasia or dysarthria. We have discussed speech in great detail in one of the previous episodes of the Medicrew Masterclasses. So you can revise the examination of speech there also. Now look at the mood. Essentially, you cannot assess mood in one sitting. What you will be assessing is affect. But you can also ask about the general mood of the person. And the general mood of the person can be assessed objectively and subjectively. Objective assessment is what the clinician sees. And subjective assessment is how the patient reports themselves. For example, objective assessment can be that the affect of the patient is depressed or elated or euthymic, that's balanced, blunted, flattened, or anxious. The patient may or may not have the same impression. The patient might say, yeah, I am a very happy person. But you know, the way the person is saying I'm a very happy person does not seem congruent. You understand, no, the happiness is not showing through the way the person is speaking. So maybe your interpretation is that the emotions are flattened or depressed, but the patient might say that I am actually very happy. Such incongruence is also important in accepting one's own state of mind. It is also usual to record any thought of self-harm or suicide while recording the mood and affect. Now come to thought. You don't separately ask question about thought. When you are talking to the person during the history-taking procedure, automatically you are analyzing the thought. Think of any formal thought disorder. By formal thought disorder, we mean the disordered thoughts that we get in diseases like schizophrenia. So there may be abnormal content of the thought, thoughts of being conspired about, thoughts of severe delusions. Is there passivity of thought? That is the person saying that, you know, actually I am not the person who thinks. There is something that is channeling the thoughts in me. They are inserting thoughts in me. These are not my thoughts. Someone has taken control over my mind. So this delusion of control also comes with a passivity phenomenon. That is, what is happening is not my intention. Someone else is getting it done by me. Are there overvalued ideas or obsessions or compulsions or ruminations? It's also important to see the negativity of the person through Bake's cognitive triad, which means inquiring if there are negative views about the self, the world, and the future. People who are morbidly depressed or those who have a nihilistic tendency might subscribe to the Bake's cognitive triad, thinking that everything is negative and nothing is going to last forever. Think specifically of the delusions. Are there delusions of persecution, delusions of jealousy, delusions of control, delusions of grandiosity? And ask them through very open-ended questions. Most of the time, the patient himself or herself will answer the questions. Perception means sensation. So you have as many perceptual disorders, as many senses you have. And these specifically include illusions, hallucinations, and sensory distortion. Sensory distortion is an increase in the sound or color sensitivity. Like what is a normal volume to everyone, the person thinks is very loud. This can typically happen in the aura phase of migraine or aura phase of an epilepsy. Sensory distortion can also happen in complex partial seizures. Illusion is a misinterpretation of external stimulus. It's like calling a rope a snake. Illusions are normal phenomena, and presence of that does not mean there is a psychiatric disorder. But hallucination is a false perception in absence of any stimulus. Seeing things that other people cannot see, hearing things that no one else is hearing, smelling something which is not there. So these are the different kinds of perceptual disturbances or sensory hallucinations. Usually auditory hallucination points towards a psychotic episode, whereas visual hallucination can be found in organic brain diseases, in complex partial seizures, as well as in schizophrenia. Now coming to cognition, the overall intellectual function of the brain. This is something which is also very subjective and very difficult to assess. A highly overrated, I should say, scale is the Mini Mental State Examination scale. But this scale actually is not a foolproof test of the cognitive level of the person. Also, the functions of frontal lobe are not properly assessed by the Mini Mental scale. Let us see how the Mini Mental scale looks like and try to understand what they indicate. This is how the Mini Mental scale looks like, and for your is I am magnifying the view. So this is the first half of the mini mental scale. And in this mini mental scale, you ask the patient, what is the year, season, date, day, and month of the day? 1 point for each correct answer. This is orientation to time. Then you ask, where are we? What is the state? What is the country? What is the town? What is the hospital? Do you know in which floor you are kept? This is orientation to place. Now you name three objects. Make sure that the three objects are not overtly related to each other. So you can name three objects like an orange, a dog, a book. Ask the patient to repeat that. Give 1 point for each correct answer. This is known as immediate recall function. And then you ask the patient that suppose I have given you a 100 rupee note to go to the market. If you keep buying chocolates worth 7 rupees, how much do you have after buying one chocolate? Then the person will answer, subtracting mentally 7 from 100, and maybe the person correctly answers 93. Then you say, you buy another chocolate of the same price. How much do you have now? So keep doing this for 5 times. And each correct answer gives you 5. In the middle, if the person is wrong, then if the next minus 7 is correct from that wrong value, then consider that to be correct. So we are actually assessing a mathematical ability which needs attention and calculation skill. However, remember, although this is a kind of a frontal lobe function, this can be difficult depending on the education and the age of the person. If you think the person cannot calculate such a high value, you can also start with a 20 rupee note and ask about buying chocolates which are 3 rupee each. So you can also do a serial subtraction of 3 for people you think for whom the previous one will be difficult. It tests the same thing essentially. Then you remember that we mentioned 3 things. So now you ask, I had named 3 things before. So can you remember them now? So if the person correctly remembers them, say for example, the orange, the dog and the book, then give 1 point for each correct answer. And this is the late recall function. So the test in between basically distracts the person. And then you assess the late recall function. So this is the first half of the mini mental scale. The second half looks like this. So language function can be tested like you show a pencil or a watch and then ask the person to name them. You show things that the person is culturally acquainted with. Repeat the following. No ifs, ands, and buts. Now, you can also use colloquial counterpart for that. It's basically giving a tongue twister without any specific meaning to see if a person can imbibe abstract words. This can also be done in Hindi or Bengali or in any other language using generics for that. Follow a 3-stage command. So on the table, you keep a paper and then you say, take a paper in your hand, fold it in half and put it on the floor. See if the person can execute that. This is executive function. And if this is lost, it can be a sign of dementia. Then you give a piece of paper on which it is written, close your eyes. You can use a language that is comfortable for the patient. And after giving this to the patient, you say, do whatever is written on this paper. So this also finds out the reading ability. Write a sentence. Doesn't matter what sentence the person writes. Make sure that the sentence has a verb. And then you show this diagram and ask the person to copy this. This is called the intersecting pentagon. It is apparently very easy, but actually it's a very complex diagram. You have to see that all the vertices of the pentagon are joined. And at least one vertex of each are overlapping each other. And only then 1 point will be given. And then you find out the total score. The total maximum score can be 30. A value less than 25 usually indicates there is a loss of memory function. As I told you that frontal lobe functions are not wonderfully measured with the Mini-Mental scale. So you can do certain other tests like tests of conceptualization. So it's like asking what is similar between a banana and an orange. These are typically frontal lobe function where abstract ideas are compared. The patient will answer that both are fruits. What is similar between a tiger and say, for example, a dog? He or she can say both are mammals or both are animals, both have 4 feet, both have tails. All of them are correct answer, but these are tests of abstract conceptualization. Then mental flexibility or lexical fluency can be found out. You choose any letter and then say as many words as you can beginning with this letter. Any word except surname or proper noun. So ideally, a person with a good vocabulary should be able to name at least 15 to 20 words. If the patient gives no response during the first 5 seconds, you say, for instance, snake. If the patient pauses for 10 seconds, stimulate him by saying any word beginning with S. Now, within 60 seconds, if the person doesn't answer, that means this function is not properly working. Motor test can be found out by a test known as the Luria test. It's a very interesting test where you can show different kinds of movements and ask the person to copy. You can also ask the person certain things to check the impulsivity. For example, you can say that, see, I'm tapping on the table like this. And you clap for every third tap. So it requires attention, concentration, and also control of motor impulse. So in this way, the frontal lobe functions can also be assessed by a variety of tests like conceptualization, lexical fluency, and the Luria's motor series test. One test that has become very popular in psychiatry is the clock face drawing test. So you ask the patient to draw a clock and point a specific time in that. You can see the normal finding has been given in the upper left hand corner. As cognitive functions decline, you will see that the gaps between letters might get changed. There may also be confusion regarding which letter is coming first and next. And the actual time that is shown might also be wrong. As the disease becomes more and more, everything becomes gibberish and nothing can be made out of that. This is what happens in late stages of Alzheimer's disease. In Parkinson's disease, starting from the early phase, not only tremor but also micrographia is an important feature. That is, the handwriting becomes small. So in Parkinson's, you will typically see things getting smaller in size. And if there is a hemispatial neglect, that the person can only see the right side of the world and not the left side of the world, then there is a chance that all letters will be written on one side of the clock and time will be shown there only. This typically indicates a kind of a brain damage which causes hemispatial neglect. Another test is the Archimedes spiral. So you can ask the patient to draw a spiral. First, you draw a spiral and then ask the patient to copy this. Archimedes spiral is a test of motor skill, at the same time, the sense of symmetry. In essential tremor, the spiral can be drawn, but there are coarse tremor-like movements visible all through. Whereas in Parkinson's disease, again, you can see fine tremors and the whole picture becomes small because of micrographia. So in this way, various possibilities can be ruled out by using this kind of cognitive function tests. Up to this, is this clear to everyone? Okay. So check the insight of the patient. That is, does the patient know that the person is sick? We know that insight may be lost in psychosis. So, does the patient believe that they are unwell? Do they think that something specific is causing it? Are they willing to accept help? So these are very important questions that will differentiate psychosis from the other neurotic spectrum disorders. At the end, you can actually ask leading question to rule out other possibilities. And this is a 1 minute screen of psychiatric condition. So ask these 7 questions. Have you ever felt low in spirits? Screening for depression. Do you enjoy things less that you usually do? Screening for depression. Have you ever been feeling generally anxious? Screen for generalized anxiety. Are you worried about your health or other specific things? This is health anxiety, can even be hypochondriasis. Has your eating felt out of control? You are thinking of eating disorders. Do you drink alcohol? If so, ask about the CAGE questions. So, ruling out alcoholism. And present 3 items and ask the patient to recall them after 2 minutes. A test for dementia or delirium. So, these should be done at the end of the interview, because if you do it in the beginning, patient will be biased. Now, how do we end the interview? It's also very important to end the interview on a positive note. You summarize whatever has been told to you back to the patient. This ensures that you have gained an accurate picture, and it reinforces to the patient that you have been listening carefully. That way, you become a trustworthy doctor to the patient. Always ask, is there anything else that I should have, that I haven't asked you, and that you think I should know? Then you can tell me. Give the patient an opportunity to ask questions. Do you have any questions? And then you explain what you plan to do next. Like you can say that, so I think we are close to coming to a diagnosis. I will be giving you 2 medications. But before I give this medication, I need to know the body functions. So I will be arranging a few blood tests for you. And after getting the reports of the blood test, you start this medication. Also, the medications might not work just from today. It will take time. So I'll see you after 3 weeks. So in this way, you summarize what is your plan for treatment. So how do you formulate the diagnosis and make plans for the treatment? Now you have enough information. You can even do physical examination like general survey to rule out organic causes. Then summarize your findings with a short précis of the relevant points. Include the patient's demography, relevant background information, chronological presenting of the symptom, relevant mental state findings, and if necessary, the physical findings. Now create a differential diagnosis. Do not forget organic causes, because they are easily reversible and require a different kind of management. For example, if a patient says, I am fatigued, this can also mean anemia. If a patient looks depressed or manic, it can be due to hypothyroidism or hyperthyroidism. Calcium abnormalities, as it happens in hyperparathyroidism, can actually cause depression. Renal failure and liver failure can lead to hallucinations or delirium. So always rule out organic causes by physical examination and laboratory investigation before stamping your diagnosis as a psychiatric diagnosis. One easy way for beginners to learn to write the etiology can be making boxes like this. So there are 3 questions: predisposing factor, precipitating factor, and perpetuating factor. And there are 3 possibilities: biological, psychological, and social. So for a given disease, you may not have all the factors. From whatever you have understood, try to write those down. So for example, suppose your diagnosis for the person is, suppose, major depressive disorder or MDD. So, was there any predisposing factor? Maybe you have found out by investigation that the patient has hypothyroidism and diabetes mellitus. We really don't know whether they cause depression, but statistically they are associated with depression. Was there any psychological factor? If you don't know, you don't know. Were there any social factors? The beginning of the pandemic, maybe. Maybe the person lost job. Was there any immediate precipitating factor? If you don't know, then leave it blank. Are there any psychological factors? Maybe the patient has mentioned the loss of a parent due to COVID. Are there any social factors? Maybe because of loss of the job, there is also a financial crisis. And what is the perpetuating factor? Why is it still going on? Is the hypothyroidism properly controlled? So check TSH levels. Check hemoglobin A1C. Are there any other psychological comorbidities? Investigate. If not on that day, on the next sitting. Are there any other social conditions that are continuing to happen? Maybe it is the same financial crisis that is continuing to happen. So although you have a very objective organic disorder like major depressive disorder, you are also planning to start drug therapy like SSRI, or you are planning on a cognitive behavior therapy. The affordability, the compliance, and the final output depends on so many other factors. That is why it's very important to think in a more holistic manner than just trusting on the neurotransmitter theories. And if you start working in this way, one day you will be able to formulate good diagnosis even without the help of a chart like this. In the DSM-4, there was a 5-axis diagnosis system that has not been followed in DSM-5, but I found this was interesting, so I could mention. According to DSM-4, a psychiatric diagnosis is written under 5 headings. Axis 1 is the clinical disorder. For example, axis 1 diagnosis of a person can be major depressive disorder. Axis 2 is a personality disorder. If the person has personality disorder or mental retardation, maybe you are talking to a person with a borderline personality, then that should be mentioned here. Axis 3 is general medical disorder, which can include hypothyroidism and type 2 diabetes mellitus. Axis 4 is psychosocial and environmental factors, which can include a loss of job. Axis 5 is done through a recording system in which you ask question and find out how the overall functioning of the person is. This is called global assessment of functioning. So maybe the score of the person is 60%. And there is a scale of knowing how the score can be interpreted. So this was the DSM-4 technique of representing psychiatric diagnosis under 5 axes. DSM-5 does not mention about this pentaxial diagnostic system. But this also shows how psychiatry as a subject is more holistic than only biological or neurological. Plan the management. If you need to hear from other family members, call for them in the next meeting. Do a physical examination to rule out organic pathology. Do blood tests and other investigations to rule out organic pathology. Do a risk assessment, particularly of suicide. Do a psychological assessment. Take the help of a psychologist if necessary. Consider social circumstance and accommodation. Does the patient require in-hospital treatment, or is there a definite caregiver at home? Plan psychological therapies after discussing a psychologist. And then you plan on the medication. You might also need to do investigation before prescribing the medication. For example, you might need to know serum creatinine before giving lithium. History of gastritis before giving an SSRI. So I think this gives you an overview of how a psychiatric history and examination should be conducted. This is a very brief overview, although not inclined to a particular type of disorder, but this can give you some idea of how psychiatrists work and how they formulate a diagnosis and plan treatment. So let's get back to the questions that we started with. So what will be the answer to this question? Wonderful. The answer is C. So the person is suffering from hemineglect. Try to answer this question. Wonderful. So this question is asking about abstract conceptualization, which is a function of the frontal lobe. Identify the condition that Mr. X might have. Very good. This is Parkinson's disease. Cage questionnaire is aimed at investigating what? Very good. It screens for alcohol abuse. Flamboyant dressing, pressure of speech, and inflated self-image may indicate what? Yes, these can indicate mania.